Have you ever had that something must be out there feeling? The name's Sam Fink, private investigator. But everybody at the agency calls me a rookie. The agency got a call from the Foundation. Seems they'd been checking out the net and had found a couple of particularly suspicious sites of which they wanted the subject matter looked into. So yet again, I was the agency's fall guy. So I found myself on a plane from LA to the middle of nowhere to visit a bunch of old stones in Wiltshire, England. My assignment was to investigate what the hell was going on around them. I was to go undercover as a video journalist. I was feeling a bit stoned, what with jet lag and all, when I first caught sight of what looked like some strange graffiti in the middle of a wheat field. I caught myself asking, how on earth did that get there? The sun was about to set behind the ancient man-made hill. A chill passed through the air. Night was coming. There was a spooky feeling about this place, that something's about to happen sensation began to seep into my thoughts. Morning came. I rented myself a micro light. This would be the easiest way to get a good look around the place and check it out. Something sure passed this way last night. Would you get a load of that? And how the hell did that get there? Now, I know I'm not alone around here, but I had this feeling like I was being watched. The white horses carved in the hillsides. There's a strange feeling about this place. My mind began to drift in directions that I didn't want to follow. Any moment I could be tripping off the planet. Not to mention the strange things that hang out here. Caught sight of a couple of aliens who dropped in from another world, or so they told me. My alien buddies drifted off into a vortex and left me in the company of this awesome new circle. I caught sight of a guy waving some strange meter around in the middle of the circle. It's time I came out of my solitude to do some face-to-face inquiries.
Yeah, well, what we're looking at here, this is the side of the circle. This is the field. A few feet over here to my left, we have the tram lines where the tractors come in to apply chemicals and things like that. And this is the actual formation itself. And as you can see, it's been laid down in a clockwise direction of, you know, I don't know exactly how big this circle is, perhaps 200, 300 feet across. It's a clockwise direction all around, and then there's these crescent shapes in the middle. And the real big mystery that people are always debating is, what is pushing this crop down? How is it done? Who's doing it? And why is it being done? And even at this point, we still don't know the answer to those questions, even about 15 years after this seemingly explosion of crop formations.
I don't really see how it could be done in about 3 hours, because it's so precise, really. And if people think it's done with the flying machines, I don't know how that could be done either. But no, it's too accurate and it's too perfect. I don't think man could have done this, really, because we'd stuff it up, actually. I don't think we're that good. Well, no, I don't think so. It's definitely something beyond us. Well, something that we are, obviously, but no, it's not done by man. It's magic.
I think that even if these crop circles are made by man, I think they're a very beautiful gift to give. It's just like the pure act of giving. And it reminds people of the land, really. And it's just a wonderful thing for people to stand up there and be able to see these things for nothing in a world where everything has a price, you know? And they are very stunning. But I still like to think that the aliens did it.
We're standing in it, so we don't really appreciate the design. The design, really, you can only sort of get a grasp on from the air. This one's 2 days old. Maybe someone will come up, will have already been over in an aircraft of some sort, and we'll have taken some aerial shots, and then eventually, fairly soon actually, these will be published on the web, and we can have a look at those. And then we can really, and then only then really, we can appreciate the amazing symmetry and design that's gone into this. Some of the designs are very, very complicated. We're talking about 194, 230 circles, all arranged with quite careful precision over a very, very large area, 500 foot. From one end to the other. So it's a complex design, as I say, only appreciable from the air. A bit like Nazca planes with these amazing designs that people have put out on with stones.
Yeah, from the air it's quite the best thing, but you even have to see them on the ground because of the details of the lay. It's very important to see the details on the ground itself. And in connection with the aerial, this gives you a very good idea of what it is.
Well, I mean, there's a wide range of theories, but personally, I feel that yes, some people are making them, some very good, skillful individuals, but also there's also definitely a genuine phenomenon intermingled with the actual hoaxes, or man-made, as I like to call them. But I believe that there's definitely an interaction happening between people and the actual shapes, the landscape itself, which is very important, I think. And some people tend to sort of see them as just purely, sort of man-made sort of patterns, but they go deeper than that. There's a deeper connection with them. And that has to do with basically vibration and geometry and how that affects the human mind, and also the landscape as well is also having an effect on people.
A guy in the middle of a field wielding a long pole? There's got to be something going on here. Whatever cut through here had to be insanely accurate. Makes you think. What's the angle? Let's face it. There's got to be an angle. There always is. Time to reflect. Seems to be onto something. These flying guys must have spotted something. They're armed to the teeth with a bunch of cameras, and they seem to be in a real hurry to hit the sky. The guy with all the cameras seemed to be trying to tell me something. The life of an undercover investigator can lead one into the strangest of situations. But standing in the middle of this little airstrip, watching all these guys take to the sky, got my adrenaline going. It is time for me to get airborne again. Up here, you get a different perspective on life. There always seems to be the wow factor. I had to get back down to the surface and lean on at least one of these microlight pilots.
We are very skeptical ourselves. You look down on these things and they are beautiful pieces of art. Personally, myself, that's where I leave it. I cannot explain all of them. I know some of them are hoaxes, and I can fly over some and see from the perspective of the air. You can see whether it's perfect or a little bit suspect. You come to the odd one and you just have to look at it and say, that wasn't there last night, and that is a fair few man hours to make. And you just stop there, else we'd end up spending as much money as our croppies do flying our machines. I would say a lot of the people that come here are from just about everywhere you can possibly think of. From Slovakia to Japan, we've had Chinese, we've had Australians, Americans, and a huge great wad of people from the continent, Germans, Swiss, Belgians, they seem to be quite severely affected by the croppy fever. Just about anywhere you can name, if we wait long enough, somebody will come and visit us from there. How they find this tiny little airfield, which is only advertised in the flying press, you know, was a bit of a mystery for us to start with, but the barge in, I believe, is the main center of the universe for the croppies. And that is where all the information seems to, you know, get known about.
I was going to have to step off into the abyss and take a visit to the barge inn. It turned out to be a pretty cool enough place, but it sure was in the middle of nowhere. I could tell the guy who ran the inn wasn't going to give me too much info, but I gave it my best shot anyway.
It is mystical, and I think it needs to remain that way. Mm. Crop circles are an art form, definitely, and I think that the patterns that are involved generate certain sort of ideas and reasoning behind them and what have you. Mm. And obviously they're discussed in the pub.
This must be the hangout for the experts. The painting on the ceiling, the acres of circle designs on the walls, not to mention the large map with a load of significant-looking stickers. Something is definitely going on here. I began sniffing around the campsite behind the inn to see what I could dig up.
How do you actually make the essence out of a crop circle?
By going in there and tuning in to whatever energies or dimensions that are there for our highest good.
Ended up following a dog into the backyard of a guy who just might be able to give me some background info on what's really going on. just a stone's throw from here, there's a site that's 6,000 plus years old, which seems to be the oldest settlement in the country that's been found so far. And it seems that those people bought, when they, I think, came to this area, they brought with them a knowledge and an understanding of not only stars, but also the patterns that we're all submersed in day after day, and built these huge shrines in honour to that, to the seeking out and understanding of these divine patterns around us. And so what better arena to have divine patterns in than an area that's already saturated with magic and esoteric knowledge and occult wisdom.
From here on, it was just like traveling down the yellow brick road. I just let the camera roll.
Amongst the Druid orders, there are as many factions of skeptics and worshippers of the phenomenon of crop circles as there are amongst the general public. And we sit and debate at length the mechanics and the rights and wrongs and the technology behind it and how it's built and how they're made and everything, you know. I'm a skeptic.
I was there on Friday with the group. There were six of us, three male, three female. And all of us have done energy work before. And we went there, it was a vision quest, and we went there to focus and meditate. We put our intention, and mine was about that I wanted whatever I've been interacting with, I wanted it to manifest in some way. I said, I don't really know how, but I was thinking more through me or just to be consciously aware. And that night was very, very powerful and magical for all of us. And we'd had a fire, and we were talking about all sorts of shamanic type things. And so in the morning, I think I was still in that receptive state, very open. And I just had this image come to me of the seed of life.
Friday night, admittedly, we had several pints of Guinness. We were walking back from the pub, and there was definitely no crop circle in the field that was to my left as we walked back from the pub. Woke up Saturday morning, there was the crop circle. In conversation with some people in Avery who had spent the night in the grove above the crop circle, under various influences, praying for a crop circle, hoping to get beamed up maybe. You can't tell, can you? And there in the morning at dawn was the crop circle they'd ordered, even the same configuration they'd ordered, with six leaves.
I thought I knew when I first came over, and I thought I had a good idea of how it was being done, and it seemed all very simple. But in fact, it's much more complex, and I think I know less now than I did then.
What do students bother to steal road cones and put them on their head? Because it's just a great laugh, isn't it? I mean, it's a whole industry, isn't it? They've just created this amazing industry by making shapes in crops, you know. I'd be hard-pushed to believe that any supernatural force can tell the difference between barley and wheat when they choose to make their circles.
There's an awful lot of sidelines going on. Some of the local pubs have sort of conference on circles. You have a lot of helicopter flights going over, airplane flights going over. It's quite big business. I mean, but the farmer, you know, we're the person whose crop is being destroyed. It makes it very difficult to harvest. And you also get the problem of numerous people going out, and especially when we're in a very dry period like we are at the moment, you know, people smoke, and you know, it creates a great fire risk as well.
It's keeping people busy. It's keeping the pilots busy ferrying tourists up and down the country to see them. The pubs are making a good deal of trade out of it.
I think that personally, you know, we used to have them 10 or 12 years ago, and we just used to have the round circles up on the top of the hills, which I think were probably natural. But all these shapes and sizes we get now, in my opinion, are very definitely man-made.
But maybe one of them's got a long-standing grudge against a farmer. Maybe they're carnivores. You know, maybe they hate plants. Maybe they're the anti-vegetarian league. We don't know. Maybe they just don't like bread or Weetabix. Not if you're a farmer, well. I think they're great. but I don't believe any supernatural forces creating them.
I regard crop circles as really a form of art, and that really people, instead of using a canvas, they're using the cornfields of Wiltshire to display their designs. And they really are very beautiful, particularly when viewed from the air. And so I sometimes feel as if I'm showing people around an art gallery rather than flying people over crop circles.
It's liftoff time again, in search of newly formed works on this ancient landscape. Let me tell you, we weren't disappointed. There they were, scattered like snowflakes across the landscape, each one with its own unique design. How can you make something as complex as this in 3 or 4 hours?
I saw the homepage on the net, some the crop circles homepage, and June and July, so many crop circles, made, and so now is the time to come England and check in this eye. So, and now I'm here.
The man maybe could make it, but not so a lot. There's no point to make it. So, I personally believe that it's mystery and alien must exist.
So, UFO, but alien. I don't know alien means. So I think the parallel world exists, and different. About ghost. They make these crop circles for us. It's a message, I think.
This phenomenon is sure pulling people from everywhere.
People are drawn, I think, to these things for whatever reason. People want to believe that there's something spiritual and something strange happening, and that there's that draws people. And also, just you're driving along a road, you see this strange thing in a field, you see cars parked up, people in there, you go and join, you join in, and it's, I don't know, it's a sort of festival feel to these things as well.
Ah, well, I mean, the first crop circle I ever went in, I met up with 10 people from different countries, and I was the only, like, born English speaker, you know, and I was just blown away by the fact that here I was. I just turned up, like, half hour previous. I met these 10 people from different countries, and we all sat down and talked about what's really important in life, you know, all the things that everybody agrees on, you know. Love is the greatest thing, and, you know, understanding and truth and the hypocrisy of society, modern society, and, you know, all these things. And we just had this immediate common ground with each other, even, you know, from all four corners of the world. And then Then afterwards, we noticed in the lay of the crop was two doves of peace kissing each other, which was like, wow, you know, after we'd had that experience and we'd all commented on the fact that it was amazing that we were all there, you know, these two big, enormous symbols of peace, we were sitting right on top of them, you know, it's like, yeah, bizarre.
That paranoid feeling began to seep back in as I looked skywards. My cover been blown? It was then that I met this chick who apparently knew where it was all coming from.
I think they're made by some really clever people who must go around in gangs and just do them as a bit of an artistic adventure to compare with all the other ones that are occurring. I think they do geometrical designs because they're easy to do. They probably know how much a corn to knock down on each side to the exact measurements, because geometrical shapes are a lot easier to measure than just flowing designs are. There's either a lot of people who do it all together in one big group, or it's a lot easier than what we all think it would be to make them. And it can just be done by a couple of blokes. It'll just take them a few hours, probably with, like, say, planks and stuff like that, just treading the corn down.
Well, I did a flight on microlight, starting over there. I made a whole tour, and actually, I crossed this field at 8 o'clock, and there was nothing, just nothing to see. And then next day, on Saturday, afternoon, we went over there because we knew there had been a new crop circle, and finally we got down here and here it was, a new crop circle. Well, I think it's kind of energy we just cannot notice by our usual ways of perceiving things. It's just an energy coming from above, coming together with energies from the earth and creating it in seconds. As far as I know, they are created in just in some seconds.
I think it's the game between mankind and nature.
Everybody wants in on the act, including the goddamn music industry.
Well, the music itself was inspired by the feeling surrounding the crop circles. So we felt that the only place that would do it justice would be to be inside a crop circle itself. And we're going to go around visiting lots of different crop circles. This one we're going to start with because it's in itself is just a wonderful, inspirational, uplifting place to be. It's a place where a lot of young people come from all over the world just to come and meet. And we wanted to try and get part of that sort of that meaning, part of that that feeling, and try and put it across and put it in the background of the video.
I had the feeling the tables had been turned, and now I was the one under surveillance. Usually comes at a price, and for me to visit this work, looks like I'm gonna have to part with some dough to the toll girl.
I've met some really fascinating people who have been very generous and, you know, really understanding about us charging, which is nice actually. And a lot of Americans come. I've heard lots of different ideas about how they're made. The main one seems to be that it's energy from the earth, something like microwaves or ultrasound, being used in some sort of way by a superior being with superior knowledge to us, or something superior to the human race.
I had to find one of these superior beings, so I snooped around the wheat fields again and got lucky.
We went up to a building site that I know and borrowed the ladder,
walked down the tractor lines of a field that we could observe quite well the next day to make a crop circle with no intention of what it was going to look like. We got to the middle of the field, to a nice spot. The moonlight was nice and bright, so we could see what we were doing. And we had this ladder, aluminium ladder, which was nice and light to carry for a distance. And my girlfriend sat on one end of the ladder, and I moved it around like that. And within, well, a minute, we had a very good circle. And the crop actually weaved itself, which was beautiful, because people tell me that in the center of the crop circles, it looks like it's been woven. The structures that I've seen are fantastical. 72 circles made overnight in a twisting double helix is astounding. There was one that looked like a snowflake or a fractal a couple of years back, and that was also fantastical. The mystery is how some people can make such complex designs. Now, we made a very simple design in a short matter of time, but how you would work out such a complex design as the better ones are is mind-blowing. I don't know how they do it. I don't know how they work it out.
Well, if I can just mention what happened at Hatpen Hill this year, a fantastic formation appeared below the slopes, and we were very lucky to be night watching on the very night it formed, actually down in the fields where it actually appeared. And we turned up around about sort of maybe 12:15, pitch black, obviously, walked along the ridgeway, which runs along the top of the actual fields themselves. And we decided sort of we'll just sit here for say an hour or so and see what happens.
There were sort of a couple of factors. One was it was formed on Saturday night, Sunday morning. We sprayed the field on the Saturday, so we'd been up and down every single tram line, so I know that there could have been no previous marking. Certainly one of the things I'd wondered if there were hoaxes that people might spend a few evenings before planning it, sticking bamboo canes up or whatever to mark out. So, but you say it was sprayed on the Saturday, so that eliminates that as being an option. I also had somebody who was out wandering around in the evening looking for foxes adjacent to that field. So I know that there was no activity on there, and that was up till about midnight. It's currently light at 4 or 5 o'clock, and as soon as people were in walking around it, the phone never stopped ringing. So I do know that if somebody had been spotted in there, I'd have certainly heard about it. So it only actually gives about 4 or 5 hours in which to have created it, which I think would prove quite a challenge for anybody.
Now, this is really bizarre because, at 7 o'clock in the morning, here's this huge formation. So they had to, if anyone had to make it, they had to make it between the hours of, say, 1:30 and 4 o'clock. Now, to me, that just seems impossible to actually produce in that amount of time. So here we are, we had a very unusual event that appeared on the very night that we actually were there. So unfortunately, we didn't sort of get to see what was actually going on down in the fields, but that formation had to be made within 3.5 hours, and I purely don't think it could have been made in that time. You would need an army of people to make that. And the organisation, I just think, is just beyond human sort of intervention. So I think that, we have to be looking at something else, surely, unless someone can come along and prove that they have to actually make it. But I think that's very doubtful, personally.
This was the Hatpen Hill Formation. It was really one of the best I've ever seen, and caused by this amazing geometry which you can't put into a field, because if you do it on paper, you have to rub out the helping lines again, and you can't do it in a field because if something is flattened once, you can't lift it up again. Yeah, and all the flow of it, it was really one of the best things I've ever seen.
I got that stoned feeling again. It was then that a break came. I brushed into a guy from my hometown. I knew he would lay things on the line for me.
I think there must be a link between the stone circles that are around here, especially Avebury, of course. But there are stone circles all over Britain, and when you look at them from the air, so many of them have the same mathematical proportions as crop circles. So what's going on here? Is it the Druids? We don't really know who built Stonehenge and Avebury, but it was the Romans reported the Druids were here when they arrived. There was no writing prior to that. We just know that there were people here, call them pagans, who worshiped the spirits of the earth and the sky and growing things, and they built these stone circles to celebrate the seasons and life, and the crop circles are celebrating life and humanity and nature, I feel, for sure. So there's definitely a connection here in archaeology and a connection in my heart between these ancient sacred sites and the crop circles.
I would be very interested to know how they did it and understand why they wanted to do it, because I can't fully understand what actual benefit they get out of it, apart from maybe the enjoyment of doing it, or the sort of the thrill, I suppose, of going into somebody else's field in the middle of the night and seeing if they can get away with it.
I mean, the ones we've seen are so brilliantly designed, and the other thing is we cannot get out over is no one ever sees them do it, so they must do it at night. And to get that precision and the markings at night, they must, I don't know how they do it, so, you know, it's just unbelievable that way.
One thing's for sure, all action happens at night. I've been given a tip-off to the location of one of the ace local night watchers. I eventually tracked him down. Yes, you've guessed it, in the middle of a wheat field. I persuaded him to spill the beans.
Another one of these occasions when I decided to sleep on the hills. I wake up at, 4:30, 5 a.m., just after it got light, and there's two huge crop circles directly in front of me, no more than 50 meters away. Unbelievable, I can't believe it. I wake up and sit up a bit bleary-eyed and see one. Wow, it's a crop circle. I stand up and there's like another one, which is twice the size of that one. That was big enough. So, obviously, jump over the wire and straight in there. This is in Bali. There's a very heavy dew, because it was clear and whatever. There's a very heavy dew. My legs were soaked, completely soaked. My boots were caked with, you know, clods of mud. You know, obviously, walking up the wet tram lines, heavy dew and all of that. So, soon I step into the crop, the first one, and because, you know, I'm covered in mud, I'm leaving huge, cloddy, muddy footprints everywhere. And not too much of a surprise, but my big, muddy footprints were the only ones present. I carefully examined the floor of the crop circle. It was perfect, neat, pristine and clean, and I was leaving big, muddy footprints everywhere, which to me is, you know, again, proof really that people weren't standing on that corn unless they were levitating, of course, just above it. So, incredible, and, you know, more Wiltshire weirdness.
I had to do something adventurous, so I got on a horse and hit the trail in search of some local riders.
Probably the most exciting moments are when you still got to the top and it's still misty, and you just go up round the top of the hill up there. And just as you crest the hill, the mist starts to clear, and all of a sudden below you, you've got patches of the veil just appearing through the mist, and the sun shines down on your face, and it's cold, but it's refreshing. That is a very, very exciting moment. And of course, when you get to the top, you then walk along the ridge, if you like, a little bit. And as you're walking along, the mist clears, and it's amazing how quickly it can burn off, especially in the summer. And then there are times, of course, when you just get there and all of a sudden, boof, the mist lifts off the field and there's a crop circle. And that is very dramatic. It's absolutely amazing. Sadly, the horses don't think much of it.
I had to grab one of these cowgirls and persuade her to get off her goddamn horse and give me the lowdown. They must have seen something suspicious out here riding around over the years.
I saw a column of light. It was not either brighter at its base or at the sky, and it was not coming through the clouds. There was no specific reason for its shape. There was no noise anywhere on the downs. And there was just, as I say, a column of light through the sky to the ground. That was on a Thursday evening. And I heard nothing about it on the Friday, but on the Saturday, when I came to see my horses here, I found cars parked all the way up the track. And on asking why there was so much excitement, I was told that a new circle formation had appeared on Thursday night. I don't know any reason. I mean, I had no knowledge of either noise or anyone in the vicinity at that time, and it was the most extraordinary phenomenon to see this light, but what it was, I can't say.
It got dark. It was a very clear, bright, starry night. I was looking up at Sirius and just looked down to my right, to my left rather, and there's a globe of light about as big as a football, probably no more than 6 meters away from me. It just sort of, I looked down and there it was. It was motionless just above the ground, and behind a standing tuft of stalks, I could see its silhouette. You know, all the stalks were in silhouette, and I had enough time to move my position and look around, and it was physically and tangibly there, some sort of translucent ball of light, and that was there for up to a minute after whatever, the minute or 50 seconds or whatever it was. It just faded and diminished to nothing.
Yes, we had a friend come up from Barnstable, and she stayed a couple of days, and we decided to spend the night at the Belly of the White Horse whilst Charlie, my husband, was in a formation in oilseed rape below. And I think it was probably about 12 o'clock when both of us saw two lights just appear in the field. And they seemed to travel towards the formation. When they got to the formation, they went out, and all I could see was just streaks of light coming from what seemed to be the top of the formation down to the bottom where I knew Charlie was sleeping. And it wasn't until the next day where we raced into the rape field to meet him, and he said, "My God, I just had the most amazing experience. You know, I had basically a close encounter with a ball of light." And I said, "Well, that's amazing, because we actually watched that light enter the field into the formation."
Of course, people have always found, from anecdotal evidence, some of which I've experienced myself in the past week, that devices often fail in these circles. The batteries drain very quickly. You get anomalous readings on compasses and things of that nature. Just a couple days ago in the Devil's Den, when I was using this static device, it froze on -3 as I walked into the circle. I'm not talking about approximately walking circle. I'm saying literally as I walked in to the edge, it died.
I really don't know what it is. I know there are hoaxes, no doubt. There are people going out to the fields making crop circles, but that definitely does not explain the whole phenomenon to me. There must be something else out there, and that makes me keep coming here, definitely.
There is no definitive answer, and that's why it's each person who's really interested in it should come and get involved and experience for themselves, because the bottom line is it's a personal journey, and it opens up a lot of questions, not just about crop circles, but about what we accept as our reality to be. And I think that's the biggest message of the crop circles.
You have the makers, the believers, and then there's this other intelligence that's having the last laugh in every scenario, it seems.
I don't think there's any doubt that the beauty and the message and the sacred geometry of these crop circles has to do with humanity and humanity waking up spiritually in time to save its ass from this inevitable ecological and war disaster. I mean, for Christ's sakes, we can't stop killing each other. Is there something wrong with this picture? Let alone worry about the environment. But anyway, the crop circles, I think, therefore, are here to help us. And that's the most important thing I can say about this phenomenon.
Well, I know that there's a real phenomenon out there, besides all the crap of hoax stuff going around, but, and this is the interesting thing why I'm coming here. It's the fascination of the real phenomenon that is able to print so beautiful shapes into the landscape and without being detected any time. So this is the reason why. And I'm looking for some answers. I don't know if we will find them any time, but it's really fascinating, the whole thing.
I felt like I was running out of time. Had to go for one last aerial surveillance. But this time, I began to get that uneasy feeling, like I wasn't exactly welcome up here. In fact, I got the distinct idea that someone was trying to get me to split the scene and head back to LA. One last shot, at night, to capture a video of a crop circle in the making. Snooping around at night with a camcorder and a flashlight wouldn't exactly produce good pictures for the foundation, but it'll have to do. Man, I was glad to be heading back to terra firma again. I was getting desperate. I needed some more substantial evidence. I hitched a ride with my new German buddy. He's one of the top night watchers who over many years has always been searching for that moment of creation. I got a positive feeling when he produced his night sight equipment.
Well, the reason why we go out that early in the morning at about 3 o'clock is to reduce the time of creation of a crop circle as much as possible, because if we know that a crop circle appeared in a very short time, let's say 1 or 2 hours, then we can put it into relation to its size and to the complexity of the geometry, for example. And this is very helpful for the analysis. The first thing is that we probably find a new formation very early in the morning, so we have this time maximum, or we see the field still empty and a few hours later somebody finds a new formation there, so then we have again the time maximum and we know that it was formed in daytime or in light, in broad daylight. And the third possibility is that we probably catch hoaxes in the act, but this is not the reason why we are here. We are not hoax busters. We are here for the real phenomenon, which we feel that it is really out there.
It wasn't long before I lost my night watcher buddy. He rushed into the darkness to investigate a sound he heard in a large field. Perhaps this time he'd get lucky. The night drifted by. It got cold and damp. My night watch seemed more and more like a bad idea. To my astonishment, there it was, in the morning light. A newly made circle, right in the middle of a wheat field, just below me. It was almost like it had been put there just for me. I was hooked. It was all over. My evidence was being shredded before my very eyes. The Foundation wanted clear explanations. Man-made. But by whom? Alien-made. Where's the proof? I could see my fees and credibility drifting away before me. Why would a guy from Tower Records hit the net and come all the way from Tokyo for a few days to check out some circles in the middle of England when most farmers seem to think it's a bunch of people making them anyway? Although one farmer I met seemed astonished by how they could be made in such a short time frame, as well as the guys on the hill that night who were mystified. A blonde chick dreams up a circle one night, backed up by a doubting druid. A guy and his girl make a simple circle on the way back from the pub. One thing's for sure, a load of people are making money off of calendars, books, conferences, photos, videos, air tours, not to mention the beer. But what about the makers? What do they get at all of this? Are there a load of Picassos out there just waiting to say, "Hi there, folks"? Suppose it could even be some kind of annual intergalactic art competition. Maybe we should just be saying, "Thanks, pals. Thanks for giving us something weird and wonderful to think about. Bringing a bit of mystery back into our lives. Balls of light? Lights from the sky? Something's out there. Or in here. What's the angle? There's just gotta be an angle." It reminded me somewhat of our tenuous place on the surface of this planet. That, hang on while you're here, cause sure ain't gonna last feeling. Know what I mean? Ghosts in the fields of what once was and will never pass this way again. Like my memories of all those cool people I met on my quest for the Foundation. All those amazing works of art finding their way onto the World Wide Web. Man, I really hope the Foundation wears the results of my investigation.